Hello, good afternoon. I'm very happy you are all joining us for an interesting symposium at this late date. I realize, though, that you will be rewarded by drinks after this, so I'm looking forward to this personally. Maybe you are too. So just one more symposium and then we'll go. So the topic of this Fujifilm-sponsored symposium is the innovation of quality in endoscopy, and then focusing on detection, characterization, but also on size of polyps. And the question is, does size of polyps, of lesions, really matter during endoscopy? And I think we have constructed a very nice program for you. And the first speaker is actually my co-chair for this session. I've not introduced myself yet. My name is Evelien Dekker. I'm a gastroenterologist in Amsterdam in the Netherlands. And Prof. Bisschops is my colleague from Leuven in Belgium. And he will give the first talk, set the stage on this topic. And his question is, does size really matter?
Thank you very much, Evelien. I wonder who came up with that title. So thanks for that. So these are my conflict of interest. So this is also kind of an introduction to what's coming next. So we know that colorectal cancer is still the third leading cause of cancer worldwide and the second leading cause in terms of cancer-related mortality. So we do screening because the rationale is that we can detect precursor lesions due to screening, and we know that this works both in the United States. We see that mortality of colorectal cancer decreases when screening programs that are often FIT or FOBT-based are introduced, and the same goes for Europe, where you can see the impact of flexible sigmoidoscopy or FOBT screening on colorectal cancer mortality that decreases significantly from 8 to 16% when stool tests are done, or 21 to 30% when flexosigmoidoscopies are done. Obviously, this only works if the quality of colonoscopy is sufficient. And when we talk about quality of colonoscopy, there are mainly three pillars that are important. The bowel preparation is obviously quite essential. And we need to be aware as endoscopists to use the water jet systems on our endoscopes to really increase the bowel prep and to get rid of all the remaining remnants that are there to increase, in this case, your BBPS score of 2 to 3. And then, obviously, during that particular task, we need to focus on finding all the lesions that are there. That's why we want to know the adenoma detection rate of endoscopists, because it relates to the risk of interval cancer in these patients. And in order to keep that up to level, you need to have a sufficient amount of withdrawal time, have a good technique, retroflex. And in some cases, if it's insufficient or you prefer, you can be helped by artificial intelligence systems like you see here during colonoscopy. And we actually know that from this overview and systematic review that the application of these techniques can help you to improve the adenoma detection rate and potentially the outcome for the patient. We're also moving more and more forward to making the correct diagnosis during endoscopy. So it's also about characterization. It's not enough just to detect a polyp and take it out. We had a nice talk this afternoon about green endoscopy. We can save a lot of carbon footprint on just throwing away all the small polyps. And on the other hand, also to avoid unnecessary endoscopies if we see that a lesion needs to be operated on, or if we need a block resection or piecemeal resection. So for that, we need these advanced imaging techniques to make optical diagnosis and make the right decision for the patient. But obviously, we can be helped now to make that optical diagnosis also with characterization, artificial intelligence tool, like the CAD-EYE system here particularly that you can see, that can actually help here to make an instant diagnosis of a small diminutive polyp and facilitate a resect and discard strategy, provided that we have sufficient specificity and sensitivity that is obtained in this particular study I'm showing here from Helmut. So where does size then come into play? Is it really important? Does it really matter when we talk about colorectal cancer screening? Well, I think it does. So the size determines the interval for the next screening colonoscopy. It determines the correct resection techniques, and it determines whether we can apply resect and discard strategy or not. So let's have a look at the guidelines. That was actually the task that was allocated to me with regard to this polyp size. Where does that come into play? So let's start with what we do most, the surveillance of colorectal polyps after resection. So the aim is to find all the polyps. And quite recently, the guideline from ESGE was adjusted a little bit, but if you can see, the size remains the same. It's 10 millimeters that we use as a cutoff to call something a high-risk polyp or a polyp that needs surveillance. The entire idea about the revision of this guideline was to actually decrease the burden of colonoscopy practice on our daily practice, hereby also reducing the carbon footprint of endoscopy by not doing too many endoscopies. But size is still there. You can see that the number of adenomas have increased from 3 to 5, and high-grade dysplasia is still there together with the size to determine a high-risk polyp. What was the reasoning behind that? Well, new evidence became available, so we wanted to do less surveillance where it was not necessary. For instance, in this particular trial looking at non-advanced adenomas, it really didn't matter whether you had more than 3 or 1 to 2 polyps to have a risk of cancer in the future. So that's why we have now the limit of 5 polyps to come back to in 3 years instead of the 3 we had before. This nice study from Poland also identified that you can actually decrease the number of high-risk patients not only by size. So if you take the definition of higher-grade dysplasia or more than 10 millimeter polyps or a villous component and more than 3, you identify 40% of the patients as high-risk. So this increases significantly the burden of colonoscopy. But actually, they looked at the national database, and you can see that only the polyps that are more than 20 millimeters here or the ones that contain high-grade dysplasia, in fact, have an increased risk. So if there's no high-grade dysplasia in polyps up to 20 millimeters, there's actually no increased risk. And you can reduce the high-risk patients from 40% to 10%, hereby reducing the need to do colonoscopy. So size, again, is here important. And then we can also talk about applying resect and discard strategy. And we don't need the histology as such because the villous component in itself was not an independent risk factor. So this is now the current guideline. The high-risk patients are the ones with size of polyps more than 10 millimeters, adenomas or sessile serrated lesions, between 5 to 9 are adenomas that are smaller than 10, and polyps that have high-grade dysplasia. And this seems to work. If we look at this recent systematic analysis, there's no major difference for low-risk adenomas versus no adenomas for the overall study population in these studies. So whether you have 5 or not, it doesn't really matter for your risk for colorectal cancer in the future. However, if you have a high-risk adenoma profile, then your risk of having colorectal cancer in the future is increased, as you can see here, by almost a factor of 3. And the same goes for the colorectal cancer mortality. For low-risk adenomas is not increased, but if you have a risk factor that was indicated by the size or the high-grade dysplasia, then there's a higher risk that you actually die of colorectal cancer. So this is the reasoning behind the fact that the ESGE guideline for surveillance has become a little bit more lean and better risk stratifying the patient. But the sizing of these polyps is obviously important, and so correct sizing is important because if you overestimate the size, it may lead to too frequent colonoscopies, right? If you underestimate the size, you may actually underestimate the risk for colorectal cancer and colorectal cancer-related mortality. And in fact, we're not that good at doing this. If we look at some studies, you can see a zigzag pattern in the distribution of the sizes of the polyps here. And you can see there's a tendency to go to 3, 5, 10, 12, 15, 20, and 25, whereas 2, 4, 6, and 9 were not so present in these measurements. Another study from Plum here indicated that there was actually a terminal digit preference. A little bit when we measure the temperature, we would say, oh, it's 38.5 and not 38.4. If you measure a blood pressure, it's 145 or 85, and we're not giving you the correct numbers. So there's a tendency to go up to 10, which obviously has a direct effect on the interval for the next screening colonoscopy, or a tendency to go to 5, which may actually wrongly indicate you can resect and discard a polyp. And again, if you look at the guideline for resect and discard, we can do this up to 5 millimeters. We can do, again, the nice optical diagnosis with BLI, for instance. And this is important because it's not because a polyp is small and pale, like, for instance, this particular one, If you keep on looking and we move to the BLI, you can actually see if you move closer that this, in fact, is a small adenoma, which you would not be able to identify with white light endoscopy because it looked more like a hyperplastic polyp, especially if you apply a little bit of zoom endoscopy like you can see here. So these are the things we need to do if we want to make optical diagnosis and probably also when you want AI to work. Coming back then to the management of the polyps, you can see that size is all over the place. So what we're going to do to the patient is determined by the size. What we're going to do to the polyp. Also, if you have a bigger polyp, again, you need to assess the polyp because there's an increasing risk that there may actually be more severe pathology inside. This is nicely illustrated here. And in our recommendations, we clearly state that if you have a polyp and you want to resect it, and we're not talking about diminutive polyps, but certainly when they go to 10 or more, you need to have a proper assessment. Like here you can see a clearly disrupted pit pattern with a demarcation line, there's friability. So this is actually a malignant polyp where you should do ESD or send the patient to surgery. And we know that with increasing size from this nice Spanish study that looked at more than 2,000 polyps that are bigger than 10 millimeters, not sure how they determine the size. That's the question, obviously, in all these trials. But anyway, you can see that there's an increasing risk with increasing size to have submucosal invasion in these particular polyps. So in conclusion, Evelyn, I think polyp size is deeply embedded in ESG and other societies' guidelines. Any adenoma or sessile serrated lesion that is more than 10 millimeters is regarded as an advanced adenoma and triggers a shorter interval for the next screening colonoscopy. So size does determine the correct resection technique as well, and it determines whether we can apply a resect and discard strategy. But, and this is what this symposium is about, the problem is we are not so good at it, and this will be addressed by the next speakers. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Raf. Very clear. I think it's indeed remarkable that we are going to more lean and mean guidelines and still keeping in the size as important as it is now, like removing villous histology because we think the pathologist isn't very good at it. But I think we are not any better in sizing polyps, especially if you look at those nice studies. Really nice. Any questions from the audience or... So we continue and maybe have some more broader debate on the end. Maybe that's better because nobody immediately rises. So let's continue. Can I introduce our colleague Ronda Notti from Como, a very beautiful place in Italy. I know it because I was on holiday last summer there. And his topic is on virtual sizing scale, a new standard for sizing colorectal polyps in clinical practice with a question mark. So I'm looking forward to your talk.
Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues, first of all, I would like to thank for the kind invitation to be here today to share with you our initial experience with a virtual sizing tool, which is something brand new and which is helpful for the endoscopist in making this sizing task. In the next few slides, we will see how this system works and how we can use it in clinical practice. This is my conflict of interest statement. As we already know, as we've shown in the previous images, as soon as we identify a polyp, in this case, there is an AI which is helping us in identifying the polyp. In this case, it is a very flat polyp in the right side of the colon. The first thing we can try to do is making our own visual estimation by comparing the size of the polyp with the surrounding mucosa, with vessels, with the other structures out there. And by doing so, we can hypothesize that this is probably a 5-millimeter polyp. So theoretically, this could be a matter of resection and discard strategy, depending on the size and the location of that polyp. But as soon as we go for removal of this polyp, we are using a tool. For example, in this case, it is a snare. It's a 1-centimeter snare. So we can compare directly the size of the snare with the size of the polyp. In this case, the diameter of the snare compared with the size of the polyp seems to be that the polyp is a little bit probably larger than the 5-millimeter we hypothesized at the beginning. So in order to support the endoscopist in this sizing task, which is not always easy, Recently, Fujifilm developed a brand new tool, which is called scaleeye, which is a brand new endoscope with a built-in laser pointer. You can activate the laser pointer just by pushing a button, generally button number 4 or 5, depending on the endoscope. And as soon as you activate the laser pointer, there is a laser beam which is projecting a point on the mucosa surface, and together with the pointer is also a ruler, which is a blue ruler here, with a scale. So we can use this ruler as a comparator for your polyp. This is an example of a lab model. As you can see, we are projecting our laser beam exactly at the edge of the polyp on the left side, and then we can use the ruler as a comparator. This is a 1 centimeter polyp. It was a 1 centimeter plastic polyp in this case. Nowadays, we have 2 rulers available in our practice, one which is a linear one, exactly as you are seeing in the left side of the screen, but there is another one which is a circular one, and we can decide to choose one or the other one depending on the size of the polyp, on polyp position and the polyp shape, which is better suitable for our evaluation. We can move from one to another one just by pushing a button again, as you can see in that video here. We can decide if we are using the linear or better the circular. We can also decide, but just by pushing a button again, if we are using a 5 millimeter scale, a 10 millimeter scale, a 20 millimeter scale. That's again depending on the size and position of the polyp on the screen and which is best for our evaluation. In the left part, in the lower part of the screen, there are all the possible available ruler and all the possible available scales we can use in clinical practice. Just by pushing a button, we can move from one to the other one. But you know that our endoscope has fisheye lenses. So let's say they generate a little bit of distorted images, let's say curved images. And there are differences in terms of distance between the tip of the endoscope and the mucosal surface. As you can see here, there are a lot of small squares. Every single square is a 5 millimeter square. But as you can see, there is an algorithm inside the scaleeye which is able to bring the make the evaluation consistent regardless if we are close to the mucosal surface or if we are going away from the mucosal surface. For each single square here, the measure remains 5 millimeter if we are close, as in this case, or even if we are moving our endoscope far from the mucosal surface. For scaleeye, an ideal working distance exists, which is between 4 and 30 millimeter, but as you know, when we are moving our endoscope inside the patient, we don't know exactly how far we are from the mucosal plane, from the mucosal surface, and we are moving our endoscope continuously, the patient is breathing, there are peristaltic waves, so it's not always difficult to exactly set our position with the respect of the mucosal plane, but fortunately, there is a card color which is extremely helpful, as in the left side of our screen, as you can see here, there is a ruler, but the ruler is yellow. This is because we are too close to the mucosa, so we are out from the, let's say, golden interval, which is between 4 and 30 millimeters, so there is no scale on the screen. It means that we cannot use it for comparison with the polyp when it is like this one. But I hope it works. Yes. When we are going away from the mucosa, we are falling within the 4 to 30 millimeters interval, and then the ruler turns to be blue, and the scale is on. So in this case, we can use it for comparison. The same on the right side, but we are going away from the mucosa. As long as we are going away from the mucosa, the ruler is not working properly. But when we are going away from the mucosa, again, the ruler turns to be yellow. And in this case, it means that we are too far from using that ruler for comparison. So when it is yellow, please don't use it. Go closer or a little bit far, depending on your position, then it turns to be blue, and then it's working. This is an example for our everyday clinical practice. As you can see, it's quite easy to move the tip of the endoscope. Sometimes you have to take a little bit of time to adjust the position of the endoscope. You have to manipulate the scope in order to place exactly the laser beam at the base of the polyp. We are interested in measuring the base in this case, so we are moving our endoscope. We are just rotating, as you can see here, placing the laser beam exactly at the lower side, the left side, at the base of the polyp, and then taking our evaluation. But why it's so important to place the laser beam exactly in this position in order to have a reliable evaluation? Because if you are placing the tip of the laser beam inside the polyp, you are underestimating the polyp itself, because you are comparing just a part of the polyp. While if you are looking at the edge of the polyp, you have to seek for that position. This is a 3 millimeter polyp instead of a 2 millimeter polyp. Of course, we are dealing with a very, very diminutive polyp here. but this applies also to bigger polyp, to larger polyp, and when we are close to 9 or 10 or 11 millimeter, that makes a big change in our management of this patient. Another point, another issue we have to take in mind is that sometimes there are folds which are close to the base of the polyp, so we need to move back and forth with our endoscope in order to flatten those folds, because we would like to avoid including in our evaluation some surrounding normal mucosa, because otherwise we are overestimating the polyp. We are making the same kind of mistake in another way, not underestimating as before, but overestimating the polyp size in this case. Another very important point, which is technical, but is has a clinical implications, is the fact that the system has been designed to work in a perpendicular way. I mean that when you are working and you are, as in this case, in a tangential position, you are not using the system properly, because as you can appreciate in this frame, this single frame, the measure we are interested in is represented by the white dotted line, which is the axis of the polyp. In this case, we are projecting our ruler in a position which is different. There is an angle between those two lines. It means that probably here we are underestimating the polyp. This is the cartoon showing how the system works. As you can see, as you can see here, when we are perpendicularly, we can reliably estimate the polyp. But we cannot do that when we are moving our endoscope in a different position, and particularly when we have a tangential position. That could be a little bit difficult task in this case, because it's not always easy to manage, because as we said before, the polyp is moving, it's not keeping exactly the same position for all the time. We are moving with our endoscope, there are peristaltic waves, the patient is also breathing, and so. So it could be a little bit difficult, but there are some little bit trick we can use it. For example, in this case, a trick which is very, very simple, but I think that's really useful, is use the freezing button, not just for picking up a picture, but keeping pressing the freezing button during the procedure, freeze the image together with a ruler. If we are not satisfied about the position of the laser beam, we can release, we can freeze again, we can release, we can freeze again, as long as we identify the position which is an ideal position for using the ruler for comparison. As in this case, for example, here, we are freezing a little bit, right now, but since we are not so satisfied about the position, we are going a little bit far, freezing again, and that could be probably a more appropriate position for ruler and for comparison. So, taking into account all the different kind of tools we have in our endoscopes, starting from AI for detection, and then turning the light to the blue light for characterization, we can also provide not only detection, but also optical diagnosis by our own eyes, or together with the support of AI, of course, as in this case. Now we have also another tool which is helpful for completing our diagnostic evaluation of the polyp in order to decide how to manage the polyp. And that's the visual estimation, the virtual estimation tool we discussed so far, because by using this, we can finally decide that this is a 5 millimeter adenoma, you have to take it out. So I can decide which is the best tool I have to use in this case. So in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues, a brand new push button technique for polyp sizing is now available in the market. It's really intuitive, as you can appreciate, it's very easy to use. It helps in providing a more objective estimation of the polyp, because we have a comparator which is close to your polyp. Unfortunately, so far, a dedicated scopes are required. The steps we have for comparison are from 5 to 20 millimeter, but I know they are already working to enlarge this measure. As I said, present time, one possible limitation is that the process requires a little bit of time, but the learning curve is very, very short. Over a couple of examinations, you became really familiar with the system because it's really intuitive and you can do it very, very quickly. So I would like to thank you, all of you, for listening. I'm very eager to see the next presentation.
Thank you very much, Emanuele, for this wonderful illustration and instructions on how to use this new system to facilitate sizing in colonoscopy. So I think we take the questions together with the panel discussion, and we invite the two of you up on stage, and so maybe think already about some questions. And it's my pleasure now to introduce the third speaker for this symposium, and that's Dr. Daniel from Rentland from Canada. Way over, and you're going to tell us what the problem is with sizing, Daniel.
Thank you so much for the kind invitation. It's a pleasure being here and presenting on this really exciting topic. I was fascinating to see the technology we have available now and also how linked it is to the guidelines. But there are quite a few problems. And one of the, what I found so interesting, the problem is the ESGE guidelines state we should measure in a standardized fashion, either in endoscopy or in pathology. And then they also state it is weak recommendation on low quality evidence. So I think there's a bit more work to do to get the evidence we need and to find ways how to better size and to better determine and follow the guidelines for our clinical decision making, because it is really influencing a lot of clinical decision making, as Ref has shown, polypectomy techniques, surveillance interval, resect and discard. And interestingly, as of now, there is no standardized way to measure. There is no recommendation how should we measure in a standardized fashion. And the other interesting thing that when we looked into all these studies in polyp sizing, also pathology is not really been validated how well it actually works to provide us valid size measurements. So what intraendoscopic tools you have available? You have your eyes to just estimate. You can take a forceps, what we've seen, or a snare where you know the size. And you can say, depending on this size, I estimate the polyp size is that big. You have calibrated instruments like rulers you can put through the channel, but we don't use them often. They're a bit unpractical and they're also costly to add. Then we have scaleeye, the virtual scale endoscope, and we have AI-based solution that coming up, maybe stand alone, maybe in combination with a scaleeye or virtual scale endoscope. So these are the preclinical studies that are out there evaluating scaleeye with different controls, with biopsy forceps for measurement, with visual measurement, with this Napoleon ruler. And overall, we find that if you use this virtual scale endoscope, you get the best results. You get a pretty good relative size measurement accuracy. And it was always significantly higher than the control group, meaning biopsy forceps. Napoleon ruler, they're a little bit better than visual, the biopsy forceps and the Napoleon ruler there, but they were not as good as this, what Emmanuel showed, this virtual scale endoscope. And then we went to test this virtual scale endoscope in clinical studies. And our first question is, what do we use as reference size measurement? And I was a bit in doubt that pathology is that reliable. And we have a sub-study running within our trials to evaluate the validity of pathology. And I'm going to show you the results a little bit later. But we decided what we're going to try to do is we take them all out with cold snare as intact specimens. We put them on a glass slide. We stain them with methylene blue so we can really see the polyp after it has been removed. And then we use this digital caliper and we measure them right away. That's our reference size of the fresh specimen. And why do we do that? Because whenever you throw any tissue in formalin, it will start to shrink. And when you look at the data that is available so far, formalin shrinkage is 10 to 20%. So you can't really first shrink a specimen and then say that will be my reference size measurement. Huh? So this was our protocol. So we found polyps. We tried to remove them really en bloc, get them out as intact specimen, and then we measured them all. And we started with a pilot study, 60 patients, where we first used visual assessment of the size, then a scaleeye assessment, and we found that scaleeye outperforms the visual assessment and pretty close to the results you find in these colon models. And also you find that the polyps, with closer to the true size is higher with visual scale endoscopy than with visual assessment. And then we went on to randomize the control trial. So we had two groups. One group we said we're going to do a visual size assessment, what we do in normal practice, and the other group we do the scaleeye measurement. So we had 230 patients. about 400 polyps found. And then what happens when you remove these polyps? Some you remove piecemeal, others you suction out through the channel. They will fracture. And so there is a certain amount of polyps that you lose, but we had in the end about 100 polyps per group. And what we found again when we measure that, scaleeye outperforms visual assessment, which is not the biggest surprise because, as Raf says, we know that we're not that good at just estimating polyp size. Huh? And what I found interesting is that when you compare the virtual scale endoscopy measurement to the true size, you don't get a significant difference, but when you use visual measurement, you get a significant difference. And we seem, or the endoscopists that participated seem to underestimate polyp size more often. And I want to show a few examples, and that's what Emmanuel said, where the laser is placed, if it's in the front, and the polyp here on picture A and B tips a little bit behind the fold. So you see the polyp is actually bigger because we underestimate the size, and it ends to being a bit longitudinal behind the fold. But you have these other polyps where you can place it nicely, and then you get quite good results with the scaleeye. So it's not a perfect method. It will have some errors and some details, you know, what you've seen in the talk before, but it works very well. So the next step we did, we video recorded all our cases, and we took out video sequences, and there's one sequence where you just see the polyp, one sequence where you see the polyp with the scaleeye information, and one polyp where you see the polyp with the snare. So we went to a group of 10 experts, Doug Rex, Heiko Pohl, really, really highly skilled endoscopists, and we said, can you please, based on these video sequences, estimate us polyp size? And what we see again is if you give this scaleeye information, you get more accurate measurements, about 10% better than visual, and interestingly, much better than snare. So snare performed really poor in this group, and that was the biggest surprise from this study. And then we looked at the snare, because you say, oh, I take a 10 millimeter cold snare. So this is the snare with which we removed most of the polyps. You have on the package, oh, it's 10 millimeter. You take it out of the package, you open it for the first time, it doesn't spring completely open, it's 8.5 millimeter wide. Then you open it again, then it's 10 millimeter wide, but you see when you measure the length, it's actually 16. Then you use it a couple of times, here in image D. Does it? Since when did it stop? Just now? So here, so we measured the slide after use, before first use, several times, and you see actually this snare changes its shape and its size depending if you engage tissue, if you open it the first time, and to an extreme of being 8 to 18 millimeter actually. And then what you've seen before, you put it into this fisheye lens environment, and then it warps the whole size of it. So it looks like that the snare is actually not a good method to base. And then we repeated the video-based assessment with a group of residents, with board-certified endoscopists, surgeons, gastroenterologists, so we have a bit more diversity in our group. And we basically repeated the same, including forceps measurement. And what we find here is, again, if you use the visual scale information, you get the best results. Forceps was a little bit better than visual, same as in the preclinical trial, and snare is kind of the worst instrument you can choose to measure size. Not significantly lower than visual, but it doesn't change anything compared to visual. But there's one thing to think about. Our clinical studies, they are populated with polyps in the range mainly between 3 to 5 millimeter. And what we also find that an instrument of a certain size helps you to size at that range, meaning a forceps that's close is about 3 millimeter large. So forceps is not bad to size something that is close to its own size, and the snare 10 millimeter, if you know the size of your snare, what it really is not that bad to size something in the range of 10 millimeter, but these clinical studies, they're really populated with diminutive polyps. So that's a little side note on this. So when you use your snare for the diminutive polyp, it really doesn't help. Yeah? But if you have about 10 millimeter, it might help. And then we moved on. We said, okay, we want to now know what our pathologists actually can do. Are they actually able to measure size? So we sent them a first batch of polyps that we measured all reference size, and we just said, we just say nothing. We just look at the report. And the first group of polyps, we don't get any sizing information back. They basically say you have so-and-so fragments, and the fragments are this size, and they routinely don't measure size. So we called them and said, hey, we would like you to measure size for us. And then they said, well, it's not that easy, because sometimes we measure the dysplasia in the polyp, sometimes the polyp. We said, we really want to know the polyp. And then we just sent them these intact specimens and really requested on every form, please measure polyp size. And after discussion with them, they said, hey, if you pin us each polyp specimen on a cork bed and indicate the longitudinal axis, then maybe we are able to give you good results. So we did this, and we had three groups, three phases, where we did these three ways. And we're hoping if we send each polyp sent on a cork embedding, we get good results. So now you go, you have your group of polyps that you resect, but then there's a high amount that fracture, that is piecemeal resected, so per se you can't really resect. And the other interesting thing we found is that sessile serrated lesions, they fragment much more often than adenomas or hyperplastic polyp. And this is what Ruff showed, this, what we assume there is, this is the prevalence of polyps of a certain pathology subtype in sizes. I think this all has to be re-evaluated based on a standardized measurement, because if polyps fracture, the pathology size measurement can't be that accurate. And what we found is that most polyp measurements in pathology come back smaller than what we measure directly after removal. And in our study, we estimated that the shrinkage effect is 25% for polyps, so quite significant. And that shrinkage leads to underestimation at the 10-millimeter border of 33% of polyps, and also 33% polyps at the 5-millimeter border. So pathology doesn't work that great. Huh? And if you look at the relative accuracy, it's a bit better than visual assessment. It's less good than virtual scale endoscopy. But you only have a measurement possible in 60% of cases with pathology. Visual, you can basically estimate all polyps. And with virtual scale endoscopy, we find about 5% where you can place the laser right. So you can measure all of them. And this was this other try where we said, okay, we're going to really embed them on cork and mark them the longitudinal axis. But in the end, it didn't really help improving pathology measurement, unfortunately. And other things I want to show that what we encounter, this was a big polyp, and we have this problem in the studies. We don't get that many large polyp. And I was really trying to get this big polyp out en bloc, electrocautery resection, and then the polyp comes out and it's completely folded in. Here, and with electrocautery damage, it's actually not that easy to fold them back up. So if you just throw that in formalin, you fixate that form, and depending where you cut, you of course get a completely different result for your size measurement in pathology than what we see in endoscopy. So I think it's the first data that really shows pathology, it can't be trusted too much for polyp size. And I think we should move to standardized intracolonoscopy measurement to base our decision on. And overall, what we found is virtual scale endoscopy is the first of these measurement methods that really allows for increasing measurement accuracy. And we found that for staff, for trainees, and also among experts. With a limitation for very large polyps, we don't have a lot of large polyps in the study, so for larger 2-millimeter, I think we're still lacking some data and some additional studies. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Daniel. So please, Manuel and Daniel, join the stage.
Yeah, so I'm I was very happy about all your work about the pathology of the size of the lesions, because we actually published, I was looking it up, it's long ago, 2010, a paper comparing the polyp size in endoscopy with CT colography. Mm-hmm. And in endoscopy, we used several moments of sizing and methods. Even the ruler, I don't know if you know that Olympus developed at one time a ruler, which was impossible to try to put next to the polyp because it was flipping over all the time. So that was actually slapstick videos to judge. But our main point was indeed that pathology is not a gold standard. So if you do any study, and that's exactly the difficulty I think we have in doing studies, as you were showing, is that pathology is not a gold standard, because you say, well, it's shrinking when you put it in the formalin and send it to the pathologist. Yeah, for sure. But I think even if you take it out, it doesn't have the size that it had in the colon. Mm-hmm. And even more so, we can debate about the size in the colon, because you know if you inflate the colon very much, the size will also change. So I think that's the challenge I have, at least, because I'm doing also some research in this topic. It's so difficult, because what is your gold standard? Mm. Can you comment on that? Because you now have more knowledge.
How do you
attack this problem?
Yeah, I think that the comment is really good with pathology, and I also think in the past we've always said endoscopists, or often said endoscopists, tend to overestimate size. You know, you find a lot
we
of
we had that in our study, and actually, you know who most? Men versus women.
Yeah.
Of course. I can say this in this.
No, but I also think if it shrinks, and then you know, of course, your measurement is bigger compared to the shrunken specimen that the pathologist looks at. Yeah, I find this method, just measuring them right after removal from the colon, works relatively well. There's a few limitations, serrated, sometimes the borders are harder to see. And what you said, if they expand or what in the colon with more air, so it changes a little bit, but you get good results for most of the polyp, with, again, the limitation for the bigger ones, you would need to do ESD to really get them out intact.
But if you want the real... So I like your last statement. We need an endoscopic gold standard. I totally agree, but you have to first measure it towards something.
Yeah, to something that's
valid. And that's challenging. I was thinking maybe a model is more gold standard, because the size of a plastic thing might not change, you know, because but then it's a model which is not how you
I think in practice. A super high quality model, because you can populate it with different polyp sizes, different forms, is actually something really important in that. Yeah. The issue is, if you do that, then you send it to a journal, then they say, oh, but it's not a clinical study. Yeah. You know, that's kind of the... But I find, because you can really say, I'm going to put 20 big ones, 20 small, 20 flat ones in. I have 6 endoscopists doing the same.
You know exactly.
You know the exact size. So I find the model studies very, very good. But they're pretty clear also that the results is that you get with a Napoleon ruler or these rulers, you get a little bit better than visual, and then with the virtual scale, you get another 5 to 10% more accuracy.
Maybe more to the practical side.
Yeah, just the practical side. I mean, this is a symposium on quality, so maybe we can show some hands and see, I mean, who does report the histology, an optical diagnosis in their report. Is anybody doing that already? In their reports? Yeah. One hand? Two hands? Okay. And who's reporting the size of the polyps? Okay. So who just uses the, how did you call that? The carpenter eyes view on that. Who just says, okay, I think this is 4, 3.
Yeah.
Well, if you take out a polyp with a snare, you usually also have your snare. So
yeah, but that doesn't always work, apparently.
No, definitely, but you have more than just...
And who uses a biopsy forceps to do this with dedication? So nobody... So it's basically just an estimation. So whether you had a colonoscopy by a man or woman, probably you will be back
several
at 3 years
millimeters.
more often after 3 years if you've
7 years earlier.
If you've had a male endoscopist. So my question to you, Daniel, is that, I mean, you allowed a 25% difference to judge how good people were in comparison to your ex vivo measurement. And we're talking about getting the new standard. Should this then be the real standard? Because Evelyn was alluding to the fact if you take it out, probably your muscle is already contracting. I don't know if you use some nifedipine in your solution that you put on there. So in real life, we're never going to do that. So is this the accurate measurement? Or now with the findings that you have, and you say, okay, we're never going to get it perfect as it is it time to really gather data like this to see what is indeed the increased risk from certain sizes based on cutters of 5, 10, 15, 20 millimeter? Is this the new way forward, or how do you envision this?
Well, I think this is the first device that can really improve size measurement. And what we've seen with this adaptive scale that knows, okay, the fisheye lens, and when I move closer or further, it adapts. It just makes sense that it works, you know, and we see that in the model and in others. So, and I think this will be further refined by AI, that AI helps you or tells you, okay, you didn't place the laser right or so, and gives you really more granularity and so and adapts. I think this is the technology push to get there to accurate.
And how about the really large lesions? Because do we need to know, by the way, if an LST is 35 or 60 millimeters? Does it matter? And will we ever be able to measure that?
Yeah.
If you can make a comment, probably over a certain size, we are not interested exactly in the measurement. What we have to focus on are thresholds. I mean, the 5 millimeter, for example, yeah, for resecting the scar, and the 20 millimeter or 10 millimeter for deciding the follow-up or the way in which we are treating lesion. To add a comment to the previous question, we are dealing now with the first available release of that system, but probably we are just beginning a path which could lead to an improvement step by step. Probably the next release together with AI and so could give also better results than that we are observing right now. So we are just at the beginning, I think, because this kind of application is not an AI. It's based just on projection of a light and on the ruler.
Just one comment or question. Do you think the studies, the guidelines are based on, do they use accurate measurement?
No.
They don't, neither.
From a theoretical point of view, we have to repeat all the studies we did so far.
Oh, I don't. Some use histology. Some use the carpenter's eye. So it's like some use biopsy forceps, but I don't think the size is quite accurate. No, well, you're absolutely right. So, Emmanuel,
that's why it's so interesting. I mean, how often do you report a 9 millimeter polyp? I mean, I never do it. I think it's always 10 or maybe 7 or 8. You might have a preference for 7 or 8, but it's somewhere between 5 and 10, right?
It's going to be 5. That's the way we all do it. It's going to be 5 with you. 5 millimeters.
Maybe.
So, Emmanuel, how difficult is it to use the system? You nicely illustrated the technical aspects, also the angulation that you sometimes have to face. And so what is the percentage of polyps that you cannot size in your experience?
I have to say that finally, when we are working with the system for quite a long time, the number of lesions you are not able to size is decreasing. But there is still 10 to 15% of polyps you are not able to really size with that system because they are partially behind folds, because you are not able to flatten completely, because you are not able to pick up exactly the right position. So I have to say between 10 and 15% of polyps remains a number which you cannot provide a size estimation accurately by using the ruler.
But now comes something interesting. The fact that you're using the ruler all the time means also probably that you're learning during endoscopy.
As we discussed before, finally, the way in which we are acting right now without a ruler is not just visual estimations, it's not just using a snare, it's not just using the carpenter eye, but it's just combining those. Mm-hmm. So probably adding also a ruler, which makes our eyes much more, let's say, educated. And probably we will be able even to improve our visual estimation just because we are used to that kind of technology in every single day, every single procedure.
So maybe for that 10 to 15%, you're better in estimation, although you are a man, than...
Very good. So I wonder, actually, maybe somebody in the audience, because, I mean, virtual chromatography has been around for as long as I'm almost graduated now. So why is it not used for characterization? Is this not important? I'm sure people do not recover all of the polyps. I think the way you recover the polyps is quite challenging. I would never be able to do that, Daniel. So how do you deal that? You just regard them as adenomas and call them as calculate them as a polyp that needs to be calculated as an adenoma. Or how do people, does anybody want to comment on that? Or we just call the patient back in 3 years then, if we don't recover the so who would do that? If you don't recover a polyp, who's going to decrease the interval for the next colonoscopy? Who would do that? No, you just, who discards then the discarded polyp? Everybody.
But do you use your optical diagnosis then? Because I think sometimes it's that's a caveat, because I think that probably should be done. Hopefully you're trained in performing optical diagnosis and you know your own performance. But sometimes if you have 5 polyps, you get your report back and you see the result of 4 and you think, oh, this is the result, right? Whereas the 5th was probably an adenoma that you didn't recover. So then the guideline changes towards a shorter interval because you had 5 adenomas, right? Yeah. So I don't know. Does everybody go by his own optical diagnosis then? Or does this never happen to you?
I think it's something that needs to be implemented systematically. Like nicely, you showed that in your video, Emmanuel, where you go from your white light, you detect a thing, yeah. And like some polyps, you identify readily as an adenoma because you can see with white light. But it's not because, it's the examples I showed was like, it's not because something is flat and looks pale on white light that it's not an adenoma. Right? So, and if we want to do the right risk stratification of these patients, so especially if you say, I'm going to, wow, this tiny little polyp, I don't care about it, not sure it's going to evolve into cancer, but at least I think the aim of colonoscopic screening is at least to get rid of the adenomas, right? So we want to get rid of them. So, and then if we have the size on that, basically you don't need a pathologist anymore because they give us wrong size. They sometimes miss the polyp. If you do cold snare resections, they don't identify the isolated lesions all the time. So I think we should be like coming totally independent when it comes down to these polyps up to 10 millimeters with tools like this, no? Don't you agree?
Yes, I agree.
5 or 10?
Well, both. I think we can go up to 10. So,
the incidence of cancers is so low, yeah. 5 to 10.
Anyway, I think that we have to take in mind that you have to be trained in optical diagnosis, even using Cram endoscopy, before to be allowed to rely completely in your performance. So, generally speaking, I suggest to stay in the safe side. I mean, if you are trained, if you are aware about your performances because participating in studies or because you are recording there and you know that you are good enough, you can rely completely on your optical diagnosis. You can be completely independent. Otherwise, if you are not, I would consider those not retrieved polyps as an adenoma and try to stay in the safe side.
But now we have AI. So how about the AI system knowing that its accuracy has been properly tested, and we know exactly that it's over the PV criteria,
soda.
Or the soda criteria. But you know, if we know we have a system that does your optical diagnosis right, also for T1 cancers. Maybe I make the discussion too complicated now, but then should you not have to be trained in optical diagnosis? Same for the system for the size.
Yeah, but studies available so far are showing that the trained endoscopy, which is using properly AI, is doing better. And I think that the AI at present time should be always considered a support from the endoscopy, so it's not cannot completely avoid the training of the endoscopist because you have to be trained in using AI also. And to be trained on the optical diagnosis, consider the optical diagnosis a sort of process, which is including AI, but it's not made by the AI itself.
I think for me personally, what the cat eye does is that for those where it's clear, like the first example you showed, the adenoma, you don't need it, right? But like for the smaller polyp, I've had it more than once that it increases your confidence of the diagnosis, or that you first think, oh, this is hyperplastic, but the system indicates it's an adenoma. You have a closer look with MBI, and then you decide, yeah, it's right or not. So it makes you think twice about those more difficult to assess polyps. Yeah. And I think this is really the support that you have. And we have to accept that the system is not ideal. But that's why you did that nice epidemiological study, Evelyn, saying that that's why where the soda criteria come from. If you have 80% sensitivity and 80% specificity, in most of the cases, you will have the correct prediction of your next surveillance interval, as long as we're dealing with these small polyps where there's no high risk of having more severe disease and cancer, I think we're on the safe side, even if you have a couple of patients that might have needed to come earlier, but in most of the cases you would predict the correct next interval. So, and that's the major change, I think, that we have with these criteria now that are clearly set forward. That means if you resect them, right? If you leave them inside, then you need to have 90% sensitivity. All right. So are there any further questions from the audience? If not, I think it's about time to wrap up the session. So I would like to summarize, and I think we can conclude that sizing at this stage is still important because it is included in the guidelines, but it's difficult to get a good gold standard. And we saw today probably a new way to get some kind of standard during ongoing endoscopy that can facilitate the sizing and also then better risk stratify our patients. And I think in conjunction with all the artificial intelligence tools that are coming up, as endoscopists, we can become independent, Daniel, from the pathologists that will not assist and give out good answers in these particular issues that we're interested in. So I would like to thank my co-chair, Evelyn, for sharing this session. Obviously, Emmanuel and Daniel for their excellent contributions, and the audience for staying in. And we see you at the reception. So thank you again. Thank you.